Today, we are going to be painting a Dark Eldar Talos, and starting with the flesh to begin with. And first, I actually airbrush some Badger Minotaur demonic skin into the flesh, because there are a lot of hard-to-reach areas on this model, and I admit afterwards I probably should have done this in pieces rather than assembling the whole thing. But after that airbrush coat, the main flesh color is actually Vallejo model color game flesh, Vallejo model color dead flesh, mixed with just a tiny amount of game color hexed lichen, and doing a very heavy dry brush all over the skin areas. Next, we repeat the process using a little bit softer dry brush method, this time with a little bit more dead flesh mixed into the previous mixture. And this flesh color I'm using here is very simple, as you will soon see. We're just using two colors essentially for most of it. And when I say hex lichen is added, just a little bit is added, I really mean it, because we're adding it to a very light dead flesh color, this very dark purple hex lichen. So a faint amount of color, because I do want a pale, very pale purple skin tone here. Next, we move up again, adding more dead flesh to the mix. This is almost pure dead flesh, but there's still a little hint of purple still in it. And we're switching to the number 2 brush, using a mixture of dry brushing with regular blocking in of highlights. Really speeds up the process, because of course the dry brushing is fast but messy. But then if you go over it again in layer steps using a standard method of applying highlights, layering, or blocking in colors, it smooths out the dry brushing. Now I've mixed in a little bit of white and starting to work on the final highlights. You can't see a lot of contrast here, because I do want a fairly pale whitish skin tone, so those light colors means not too much contrast. And then finally, for the last highlight, mixing in a little bit more white once again, so we're working almost with pure white, and adding just a few extra highlights to the larger muscle areas. And with that, the painting of the flesh is done, but now we have to work on the shading and the bruising. From this stage forward, we're going to be concentrating mostly on washes and glazes. And the first wash is an overall wash of Vallejo game color royal purple, and that's done mainly in the recesses, but somewhat overall. But basically, I'm trying to avoid all the highlights I just did, because I don't want to bring those back down into color and then have to repaint them later. Next comes a wash of game color stormy blue, and applying it still in the recesses, being a bit more careful at this stage. And the reason why I'm going with stormy blue now is because I want to add a bit of color. I want a bruised flesh scheme for this guy, so we're going to be changing the colors up a little bit using a variety of colors, so we're not just sticking with purples here. After the stormy blue wash was dry, I mixed in a very tiny amount of Vallejo model color deep green in with the same mixture of stormy blue, and now I'm applying a very, very light glaze in any areas where the flesh might be bruised, so any areas where the flesh meets metal, with the idea of, you know, the flesh being damaged as the metal's being welded or fused onto their skin. And this is built up in a few layers, allowing each one to dry before moving on to the next. With that, the flesh is done, and the tedious work is done, so now we can have some fun with the armor. And I started off with base coating with Vallejo Panzer Ace's Dark Rust, and now I am stippling on Panzer Ace's Light Rust, and doing it in a haphazard pattern. My main concern here now is just making sure I don't hit the flesh, but doing stronger concentrations of the lighter rust orange color, and some places a little bit weaker. I want a broken up variety pattern at this point. Then we take some Winsor & Newton masking fluid, which is essentially just liquid latex, and stippling that over the armored areas using the same method that we just did. The only difference is that I'm using a different brush here, because once you put a brush into the liquid latex, it's gone, you ruined it. That's why I always save all my worn out brushes for occasions just like this. But the masking fluid is being placed on mostly the edges of the larger plates towards the ends, but I'm doing a little bit here and there as well. So essentially all over, but concentrated more on the edging. With the rusted areas now in place, I can start with the main base coat color, which is Vallejo Model Color Dark Blue Gray, mixed with a little bit of chocolate brown. Now what I'm doing here is essentially mixing two weathering techniques together, one being the latex masking, and the other being the stippling technique here. Didn't know how it would come out, I just wanted to have fun and experiment, and make a really beat up looking Frankenstein monster type of contraption. Next, I repeat the stippling process, this time with a little bit of Game Color Electric Blue mixed in, and that adds a bit of color back into the scheme. The point of the chocolate brown was to dull the blue-gray. The point of the electric blue is to bring it back up. So it's a very dull, worn surface, but closer to the highlight areas, it brightens up a bit. And again, stippling process the same as before, but as we move up, and you'll see as we go on, concentrating more on the tops of the plates and working towards the larger inner surface areas of the plates as well. The next layer, once again, stippled on, this time with a little bit of Game Color Wolf Gray mixed in. Again, as I mentioned, working towards the edges, away from the areas where I put the latex, the main areas where I put the latex. So we have a gradation of rust and oxidation and working towards the highlights, just as we would if we were doing a normal brush painting. And now we've reached the final stippling layer, again with more Wolf's Gray added. And if you're using this technique at home, actually, the more you do this, the less corroded the object will be. I want this fairly corroded, so I'm being very haphazard with the stippling. I'm leaving a lot of the previous layers showing through here and there. If your brush has more paint on it, you'll get a more solid-looking surface, which is therefore less corroded, less rusted. So there's different ways you can do this. And then finally, we finish off with a little bit of edging by mixing some white into the previous mixture. And notice I'm not making a straight solid line. I'm kind of skipping the brush along the edges to keep with that theme of the broken up pattern caused by the stippling, doing a solid edge along these areas where the rest is very broken and mottled looking would not be appropriate. Now that we're finished with the armor, we can go ahead and remove the liquid latex. And a couple different ways you could remove it. You can use your finger, like I am here. However, that is a bit difficult getting into the hard-to-reach areas. Or you can use the eraser end of a pencil, or in the case of what I did, was I used the stippling brush that I previously used for the liquid latex, which was now dry. And the nice thing about the liquid latex, it tends to stick to itself. So I'm going to pat myself on the back here because I couldn't find my pencil. I just tried this and it worked out really well, and I remembered that fact. But at this point, we're just trying to remove all the latex that we can. You can actually leave it on some areas if you want it less rusty here and there, because hopefully, if it's applied thinly enough, the liquid latex will not show under all those layers of paint. After cleaning off all that latex, I decided I wanted a bit more rusty color inside the recesses of the plates. So I'm using some thinned Vallejo model color chocolate brown and just applying it carefully into the recesses, doing it in a kind of stippling method. I guess I would call it just more haphazardly, just so it's not a straight line. Again, adding to the whole model theme of all the stippling that I previously did. And then finally finishing it off with some Vallejo model color orange brown. Once again, applying it in that sort of stabby stippling method, so I get a nice broken pattern with that nice orange color. And not applying it everywhere, just in a few spots for a little extra zing to my rusty monstrosity. Next, we move on to the metal bits, and I am using Vallejo model color air steel mixed in with some model color regular black to tone it down, because obviously I don't want shiny clean metal on this ugly looking rusted thing. For the highlights, we're going to use straight model color air steel, carefully dry brushed on. And when you're dry brushing with metallics, you got to be really careful because they're very thin and they tend to flick off the end of the brush if you're dry brushing with them, and that could lead to getting sparkly silver paint all over the rest of the job, paint job. So just be cautious. Don't scrub too hard. Because I speed up the footage here, it does look like I'm going really fast, but I am going slower and being more careful, so I don't end up getting paint all over the place. For some rust and for some shade, I broke out the AK Interactive Rust Streaks and applying that all over the metal areas. And normally I would do a gloss coat first before applying the enamel wash, because that helps to prevent the wash from seeping too deeply into the paint and staining it the same color, and makes it easier to remove. I didn't do that in this case because I wanted a very rusty look to this metal. So apply it all over the place, let it dry in about 10 minutes, and then we can take it off. So after 10 minutes, removing the wash from the raised areas now using a massive amount of Q-tips, and kind of hard to do it on this project because of all the spiky bits. And just because I know someone tells me every single time, yes, you can use makeup sponges or applicators as well. However, I prefer the Q-tips. I think they absorb better. For the chains on this monster, I decided to go with something, well, experiment with something, and I wanted a darker, more iron look, so a darker metal. And so I'm using the same steel colors before for the metallic sheen, but I mixed it with a large amount of Vallejo model color German gray, and I think I mixed a little bit of cold gray in as well, so I ended up with a dark matte metallic, essentially. And that's going over the, I think it's called a flail fist, I'm not sure what it's called, and some of the other chains that are here and there on the model. And then that was followed up with a very heavy wash of Vallejo model color brown orange, the same color that we used for the rust on the armored plates up above. The secondary color in my army is red, and I did paint the hoses red, actually hull red, model color hull red mixed with some model color flat red with some Panzer Aces flush base to highlight, but I thought it still needed a bit more red, so I'm going around with some flat red, applying it inside the recesses on these little heater coil looking things up above, as well as a few of the tube-like things on the bottom. Yeah, I'm being real technical here. And then for the highlights, mixed in a little bit of model color yellow, trying to concentrate on the center of the heating coils. And on the other tube areas on the bottom, I went much more extreme with this. You can see it, some of the orange right now, but I went up to almost pure yellow on those bottom bits. The reason why I over-highlighted the tubes on the bottom here is because I plan on going over them with straight red ink. And that's kind of a little quickie way of painting glass items. Over-highlight it and then put an ink over that. Actually several inks. And it does tend to give it a sort of glassy look to it, even after putting a flat varnish on it. And it's a lot easier. It's very easy to paint as well. So I did about two or three coats of the red ink, and then I eventually decided to go a little bit darker with them and mixed in some brown and did a couple coats of that as well. But after that, it's the flat varnish, tester's dull coat, and we're done. And there we go, our finished Talos. And fun little project. The experiment with the stippling mixed with the latex is not two techniques I used together before, but I really like how it came out. Would work really well if you want something really beat up, but there are changes you can do to it, like go heavier with the paint that you're stippling on over the latex. Also, I did play around with a little bit. I didn't mention it because it really wasn't worth it, but I did pull off the latex in a few spots during the painting of the layers, so there was a different effect here and there. So there's things like that you can do, and a lot of things you can play around with using the liquid latex for the masking. But overall, fairly quick build. If you're building one of these yourself, I would leave it more in pieces than I did. Those tiny arms on the sides, for example, leave those off, and maybe leave the entire top armored bit, the carapace, off as well and paint that separately. But other than that, it was fun, and I hope you enjoyed watching, and see you again real soon.